Can I just do this? It seriously is a privilege. Actually, at my age, it's a privilege to be anywhere, but particularly here. And I just want to get you to do this. Would you please acknowledge that there are a lot of people tonight that have made this possible? Could we just say thank you to people at One Singapore and everything else? Very, very good. Okay. So can business do well and do good? I'm indebted to Clive. Let me just turn this on and then I'll... There we go. I'm indebted to Clive. Where are you, Clive? Wherever. Thank you, Clive. Clive earlier on said, actually, because I just had that slide, and then Clive said, I heard someone on the BBC this week, I think it was the BBC, Clive, yeah, saying this, and I absolutely agree with this. It says, businesses cannot do well unless they do good. And I'm absolutely convinced that in 5 to 10 years from now, every business will actually have to be doing that. For example, in the US right now, there are seven states, seven of them, that have laws that essentially say, unless you're doing good, you cannot register your business in this particular state. And so we have to believe that that is where the world is moving. But the world has been interesting this year, hasn't it? Because we've had all these natural disasters and things. We've had, you know, the floods in Queensland. This is Queensland, Australia. We had the earthquake down in Christchurch. We had floods in Brazil. We had earthquakes in Japan and tsunamis and all those kind of things. And it's kind of interesting what happens, isn't it? Don't you find this interesting? It's like when we have those disasters, the other side of it is that people come together in a way that they've never come together before. And I find that really interesting. Someone said, for us to really get it, we need to have an alien force invade us. And then perhaps we would all come together in an interesting way. But these floods were kind of interesting, and they lead somewhere. So stay with me. So you see, they were pretty interesting. This is the police force in Brisbane, Australia. There. This is a little town that had never seen water before in its life. This is actually on a mountainside where they had never been flooded before. Kind of interesting what happened. The TV reporter was interviewing one of the ladies who was in this flood. She was 65 years old, and she explained that, and she's standing next to her husband, and her husband is incredibly frail, and she's standing next to him, and she doesn't have any teeth in. And the news reporter says, so Jean, how was it when the floods came through? And Jean said, oh my God, they came through so quick that I had to make some choices as to what I would save. She said, he's pretty frail, so I chose to, this is without any teeth, right? He's pretty frail, so I chose to save him. And then she said, frankly, at this moment, I'm not sure I made the best choice. So it's kind of interesting in relation to that. But anyway, we had these floods, and here's the premier of Queensland. Her name is Anna Bligh. She is being compared right now with Rudy Giuliani, and what Rudy Giuliani did, her popularity before the floods was somewhere close to 22%. After the floods and during it, it went to 87%. She was that kind of cool in the crisis. And what happened is, as the floods were going down, Anna came on TV and she said, we need 6,000 people to clean up the mess in certain suburbs of Brisbane. Anna did not get 6,000 people. What she actually got was 80,000 people. Now, there's a beautiful, I think, message for all of us in business about what happened with Anna Bligh. Here's the message, well, there's the people turning to clean it up. When the sense of purpose is big enough, people will do amazing things. Now, we get that when there are disasters and all of those sorts of things. Part of my mission is to help business get that at a business level. Because the reality is, in business, when your sense of purpose is big enough, your team, your people, will absolutely do things that will amaze them and amaze you. And giving back is part of that. So let's just take a quick look in these 8 minutes or so remaining at giving. And I want to make a couple of observations. You're going to see some things about typical giving. Now, when I look at these, please don't imply, I do not wish to imply that there's any judgments that this is right or this is wrong. What we see, though, is a lot of businesses saying, as in sort of pumping the chest and saying, we gave X dollars to charity, which is a beautiful thing, right? But there are a couple of issues I would suggest with that. Issue number one is that it's usually short term, And the bigger issue, I know, is that there is minimal connection. Minimal connection, I mean, the board of directors are probably connected to it, but you and I as customers are not. Does that make sense? Yeah, these are the easy questions, they get harder. Okay, so I'm assuming yes. The next level we see is, you know, telethons and all of those kind of things. Again, nothing wrong with that, except, you know, for example, 2 years ago, I think it was, we saw 12 telethons in Singapore. Last year, we saw 3. And the reason was, I used to think that the TV stations gave that airtime for free. They don't. And so all of a sudden, charities were saying, hang on, we're not getting the bang for the buck. Does that make sense? So again, nothing wrong with that, nothing wrong with this, nothing wrong with any of what we've been talking about. It's great that it exists. But what if there was a better way? What if there was a way that, oh, by the way, don't you love that? The other thing that goes on, I'm sure of it, with most charities, isn't that cute, fella, is that most charities, most giving, if you will, comes from trying to make us feel guilty. Now, the problem with that is that guilt is absolutely not sustainable, because neither of us want to feel guilty for the rest of our life. So there has to be, if you will, a more interesting way. By the way, this is kind of interesting. You know, you can do stuff that I swear that cat has been ironed, by the way, I swear. Or you could try this, parents killed by ninjas need money for kung fu lessons, revenge is sweet. So there's all sorts of ways, right, of doing it. But if we were to take a look at it, most giving that we see, no matter where it is in the world, and by the way, interesting enough, if you look at the statistics, you find some interesting things. For example, of the $380 billion that in 2009 in the US was given to charity, staggeringly enough, only 4% of that came from business. Only 4. Does that stagger you? Because that blows my mind. And part of the reason, I think, is because of some of the things that we've just seen. So most giving is one-off, or if you like, ad hoc. That's an advertising term there. It's ad hoc, and of course, there's minimal connection. But what if it was not that way? What if giving was actually habitual? What if giving was, in fact, a natural part of you and I doing what we do? And what if giving had maximum connection rather than minimal connection? It seems to me that the answer to that what if is, it would be kind of interesting. So what I want you to do is to imagine just for a moment, in fact just for 2 minutes, I want you to imagine a different world, a world that we're creating right now. But come and imagine this world with me. Hopefully the sound is up as well. It is.
Sharing the joy of giving every second, every day. in every way.
Oh, thank you. I get to see that a fair bit. Matter of fact, it's the second time I've seen it today, but I can't watch it without the lump coming. For those of us who've seen that for the first time, many people go, wow, that would be kind of an interesting place. Can I see your hands if you do? Yeah, it would be kind of interesting, wouldn't it? Because if you go back to what Zuby was saying and you look at how we're missing on some of those Millennium Development Goals, then surely one of the way of fixing it is to not make it optional, but make it, in effect, a habit, so that everything happens habitually. By the way, this is now happening in our last annual report, the most recent one. Really interestingly, as a result of this process right now, there have been 1.4 million, I think, yeah, 1.4 million beneficiaries of this process, just from businesses doing what we normally do. So, final point, talking about businesses, nearly finished, Zuby, believe me, I have. If my clicker would work, it would be really good. Why is my clicker not working? Let me just go over here and it should work. Ah, there we go. This is an email I received just this week. Now, you obviously can't see that email, so let me just blow it up for you. I've learned not to say that, by the way, in Los Angeles, because they take it literally. So anyway, this is a little email from a guy called Giovanni. Giovanni is an Italian guy, rather obviously. He runs an interesting little building company in Brisbane, in Australia. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but I want to get to this, a couple of things. We've spoken to our team, he said. See, Johan was talking about the importance of this, and asked if they would like to be a part of the giving experience. And you might guess what their response was. The reality is people are now choosing to join organizations that give, as opposed to organizations that don't. He goes on to say, we've done B1G1 already. The lady was critically ill. What I find so interesting about this, he says, I started to well up, and when I left, I felt that not only had we helped 150 children in India. Now, the most significant thing about that is until that time, he was talking about building pools. Now he's talking about helping 150 kids in India. Do you see that shift? It's a really, really important shift. He says we're now connected to our clients. That's such an important thing to get. And then the final thing is, he says here, look at that. Our business has transformed. So does business, or can business and doing good kind of coexist? I would say it's much more than coexist. I would say that once we really get it, we open up a space and, quite seriously, our businesses transform. By the way, you notice Masami Sato down there. It was she who founded B1G1, and she was to be here tonight, but she is very, very sick in bed, which is upsetting her because she was running the marathon tomorrow. She can't do that. But anyway, she sends her love to you. So thank you, he says, for this opportunity and privilege. Businesses, again, cannot do well unless they do good. I hope as a result of this, you too have gotten that message, so that together we can make these Millennium Development Goals easily achieved. Thank you so much. Thank you, Zuby. How'd I go?
Yeah, that's great. Okay. We got any questions for Paul? You're also starting with this.
Vanessa's question is, how many businesses are there now on board with B1G1? It's somewhere close to 500 right now. By the way, can you put that back just one second? Because there's another reason, and I forgot I had this slide. It should detect it.
There we go. What happens, I'm absolutely certain, and you saw Giovanni say it, is that the moment we get giving, not giving to get, but giving to give, right? It's an intent that goes on. Our businesses transform. So why might we do it? Well, because our businesses transform, but it's actually bigger than that, Clive. Because when our businesses transform, I'm running on reserve power. Okay, what that actually says is this. Thank you, Mr. Jobs. What it actually says is this. When our businesses transform, I'd love you to get this, then our nation transforms. And when our nation transforms, then our world transforms. So that's what I'd love to leave you with. Okay. Thank you.